lab with my speakers loud. Never been one for commercial sound. I'll concentrate the music, independent crowd. Aesthetic intellect is a label found. Representing our cause, hold the applause. Listening as I begin to get the message across. I never been a bitch, I never been a fraud. Bringing MCs to light, tearing down the facade.
Welcome back. It's week three of Beers in the Air. I'm your host, Gibbs.
Co-host Ziggy Braun over here.
And this week, we bring you another member of the Monkey House.
T-H-A.
T-H-A Monkey House. His name is the incredible Saint.Eve, a.k.a. Saint Even. What is up, my man?
Hey, not much, you guys. Thank you for having me.
Well, glad to have you, man. This is going to be a great one with you.
Thank you.
This has been almost 3 weeks in the making.
I get it because it's episode three. But no, he's been one that we've been talking about since the start of it. You know, we definitely want to get this guy on and pick his mind.
Thank you. You guys are awesome.
So we introduced ourselves. Let's introduce yourself, who you are, what you do, and all that.
My name is Saint Even. Thank you guys for having me again. I'm here. I do music with Mr. Ziggy Braun over here. Ziggy Braun currently unmasked.
There is in the studio unmasked.
Oh, no, nobody knows Dude. Though.
No bandana over his face.
No bandana, no luchador mask. No mummy toilet paper around my face. We haven't.
Oh, that one's gonna be great.
I just let loose the secret.
Fucking mask off.
For episode 25.
There we go.
Well, this week we got the exclusive Saint Even interview. This is going to be a load of fun. This guy's a very interesting person. He's got a lot to say, I'm sure. This week, we've got two six-packs again this week like we did in the first week. We've got Deschutes Brewery, Fresh Squeezed IPA, and what's our other one?
And we got the Kona Brewing Company Longboard Island Lager.
It's all good. I'll cut that out.
Wait, what?
It's a nice mouthful.
I threw your government out there. It's all good.
Oh, you did.
No, it's all right. It's all right. The masterful power of editing. And, of course, we're going to close it out after all that with another segment of pure fuckery.
We talked about a lot of stuff last week. It was a good one.
Yeah, that guy Dylan Drugs is a character, man. He's a crazy guy.
Love that dude. Dylan.
All right. So, this has been our intro. We'll be right back, and we're going to get straight into the Saint Even interview.
And straight out the bottle.
Bring it home, Saint!
Born sinning like I'm Cole. Ain't him because I get my molars straight. Fake rims you pray to your soul to take, but everything's okay. Let us know I got the solar tank. One of those roller things in GTA is a coke plate. JK, but I'm still down to rage. I'm a logo, but I'm not on probation. Relations with your bitch in the gas station. Bathroom while on shrooms. And they all black like they ain't con. They all rotten. Your rhymes is gotten soft. And I'm throwing Molotovs, bitch.
Straight out the bottle, straight out the bottle, straight out the bottle, straight out the bottle. No chaser, no chaser, I'm a dog, she's a cat, I'm a chaser, I'm a chaser. Straight out the bottle, straight out the bottle.
Now what we're going to do is we're going to get to know the man behind your mask, Mr. Saint Even. Let's start off with a little bit of history of yourself as far as being an artist and when you started, what you've been a part of, and just let the people know who you are.
Absolutely. Well, I feel like I've been doing artistic stuff for pretty much the entirety of my life. You know, I was always really involved in something artistic, whether it was drawing or playing instruments or acting or doing on stage.
That's right. I don't mean to cut you off, but we were literally just talking last night about you and not directly about you, but you got brought up because of a story I was telling. I might even tell it during pure fuckery because it's one of those stories. But basically, it was when you were the lead on the school musical.
Oh, yeah.
And how that led to me not going to college. So there's the little hint of the story we're going to hear later.
Comedy.
But,
that's comedy. I can't wait to hear
yeah,
it.
Yeah, just FYI, too. Satan and I are both thespians.
Yeah, a part of a thespian troupe.
Yeah. Mm. Got our hours in with the acting.
Yeah.
Are you part of the guild?
We are.
Oh,
no, I'm not. No, we're not.
Illuminati and all that.
Damn.
You know.
All right, sorry to cut you off. You're artsy, music, drawing, whatever, acting.
Doing all sorts of stuff. It's always been like that, but I've always had that thrust upon me. I feel like in my life I've had a few good teachers, a few really good ones. And that's really all it takes to really like spark your imagination. You know what I mean? Get you there as far as on the plane.
Someone to help you think outside the box a little bit. Just
absolutely. Thinking about something bigger than yourself. Expression was always really stressed in the educational system in my first few years. Then it all went to shit, though. Like, it was terrible after that. But I'd say, like, who really, like, helped spark it was, you know, my folks listening to what they listened to, doing what they did, you know, watching what they watched. And, you know, the teachers that I had at the time too, really, well, it was the 90s, you know, everybody was like free and shit. Nobody was worried about anything. Not really. It was a good time to grow up. It's a good time to grow up. You know, you guys were there.
you were there, you know.
It was a pretty good time. I have to admit that.
Yeah, I'd have to say my time growing up, for sure, I'm glad I grew up when I grew up because it was like the last, like, real peer, I'd say what generation?
Oh, yeah.
Before the technology generation.
Yeah,
absolutely.
Because, I mean,
we had Pokemon cards and yo-yos in class.
Yeah, like Pogs and stuff like that.
Marbles.
But, I mean, my face is in my phone from time to time. I mean, we're probably all guilty of it. We've all got our smartphones out right here, you know what I mean? But we also aren't, like, 6 to 11 years old, buried in a tablet, watching YouTube. I mean, YouTube was revolutionary for us, you know what I mean?
You know, it's interesting because we've had a taste of life before technology really had a boom.
Kind of took over.
Yeah, absolutely.
I mean, I agree. We were all there growing up through that same childhood.
Yeah. Well, I'd like to say, though, that it really affected me in the way that I, you know, approach life and art and everything. You know, it's funny because I always felt like conditioned to fight like some sort of
battle or war.
Yeah. Yeah. You grow up feeling like that, especially when you're a person like me or a person like you guys. Everybody's got their own, you know, struggle that they go through. You know, silently, but it's funny because it's always felt like there's like this common enemy that we've always been like out for, and I think once you get older, you don't really know what it is anymore, or you just feel the pressure to succumb to the powers that be.
We're all just Batman, essentially fighting our Joker. Yeah. Pretty much.
Damn.
Yeah, I could get a little
real.
I could get a little deep. Some comic deep.
There you go.
All right, let's talk a little bit of TMH because as long as I've known you guys,
it's a bunch of house monkeys.
It's been TMH. So I mean, it started as a certain group, declined to a smaller group, and then got large again. Not large, but you know, one member bigger. I just want your perspective on it. I talked to Ziggy 2 weeks ago about some TMH, but I mean, eventually we're going to have you all on, and I want everyone's perspective of TMH. You know, the goods, the bads, the best, the ups, the downs, you know what I mean? Just let everybody know everything about TMH a little bit.
Right on. Well, the early, I guess, like, blueprint for the TMH thing would be, you know, obviously, son of a bitch.
the magic of editing.
Obviously, Mr. Ziggy Braun and I were
Ziggy Braun, son of a bitch.
You know, involved in the same sort of activities artistically back in the day. So he suggested that we collaborate on something a little bit more gangster, you know, than what we were doing at the time.
Well, I remember you broke me into my whole kind of music recording, you know, with the last donut of the night.
Oh yeah, no, yeah. Absolutely.
And that kind of just branched out from there. And
that was the start of your long, fruitful career of being an audio engineer that you probably never thought that you were going to take part in.
I definitely didn't think I was still going to be doing it with the same group of people this far down
this
the road.
This many years later.
Which is cool. Yeah.
Which, I mean, it's almost been 10 fucking years.
Yeah. Absolutely. Yeah.
And
which is crazy.
Better every single year.
It does.
I feel like we really get to hit our stride with this, too. We got a lot coming. It's fun knowing that you find out like life is long and you can do a lot in it. I've never really had any sort of want to be like anybody else as far as other projects go, you know, like other rappers, you know, other bands and stuff like that. Never really been interested in like following their timelines. More so interested in coming up with a feeling, you know, for everybody to enjoy and making sure that they enjoy it.
I think we definitely accomplished that too with what we did come out with, you know, because like every album I'd say is different than the previous one. You know, you never know really what to expect. We approach it in different styles and have different production, you know, on it.
I mean, that's always a great thing to have too, because no one wants to buy the same album.
Right, right.
I mean, they generally want the Monkey House still when they buy an album, but they don't want the Monkey House Yellow album
when they buy
on the next album that's not the Yellow album, you know. So they want that new feel, and it's almost a weird thing for a diehard fan of music, like some of the artists I listen to, like I don't want to hear the same thing I just heard, but I still do, you know. It's a love hate, and then you sit there and you listen to the album at first, you're just like, man, the last album was so much better. But until something really grows on you, you're just like, oh no, this album's fucking dope.
Absolutely.
I don't know if you guys feel the same way about some albums like that, but like I gotta listen to something like maybe 2-3 times all the way through until I'm really definitely like, yes, I got this.
Yeah, you know, I always like to say that you can enjoy songs better in a different context entirely. The ideal context for me to enjoy a song in is hearing it when you're like, okay, so imagine like being, well, do you guys ever play music when you're asleep?
Yeah, all the time.
Yeah. Okay, so all the time. I do that all the time. And I like to wake up, you know, just take a leak or whatever, but when you hear whatever's playing in the background, coming from whatever device you have it playing on, and you come and you come into consciousness and actually hear what's going on, can sound completely different, you know, than what you've heard it at.
It's because almost in that sort of state, you're like almost at a slowed down state, like an at peace state. So you're like really hearing things for like the first time, even if you've listened to it
absolutely
a ton.
I'm like constantly listening to different types of music too, like that, just letting it play. I've got a phone full of music that I haven't fully heard. Like sometimes I'll put my device on shuffle and just let it play, and I won't know what song is playing. It'll be like a stretch like that for like 45 minutes or an hour.
I think Sane gave me like a couple gigs of music a while back, and I still haven't gotten through it.
Yeah,
he just always hooks it up with music.
Music is such an important thing to me, and I've been hoarding it away for so long. But just learning a lot about it, learning how vibration affects people is really dope, you know. And I would hate to like release something that I didn't think was gonna like have an effect that was ideal, you know.
Yeah,
like I want to put a lot into something and make it something worth making.
Yeah,
you know. And however much time it takes to make that, or however much time it takes to do that, that's fine.
So the way I see the Monkey House currently is like you guys are almost like at that I mean, it's completely different, but almost at like that Destiny's Child stage, you know what I mean? Where everyone's kind of like doing something different right now. I mean, you guys used to be together recording stuff consistently, but right. I mean, that's
Scum just is not, Michelle Williams.
that shit's just not possible right now. But like in a different way, maybe at the Wu-Tang stages would be a little better. Like when they started all branching out, going solo, just because I mean a lot more success came from them individually than
solo stuff.
We've always kind of had the Wu-Tang Clan in mind.
What I say before Destiny's Child? Because what is there's Beyonce and then the other two. Like
shout out to Wu though. Wu was always doing their thing. Always pushed a lot of Wu onto the guys as much as possible. But they just, you know, I think they demonstrate that you can coexist, you know, as a group and together and still have it be one cohesive
and being
thing.
So diverse at the same time, which that's a big thing with you guys was how diverse you were.
Absolutely. Yeah. There's 4 different stories being told at the same time. And, you know, whether I like what's going on, like 100% or not, just to know that, you know, we're giving it an opportunity to exist is enough for me to enjoy it.
Yeah, sometimes sacrifice is like one of the best sorts of discipline I think you can give yourself as a human being. Just knowing that if you're willing to give up something in order to make something work, that makes you a very wholesome and strong-minded human being, just because not everyone's able to do that.
Absolutely.
And to make a group work, which I've been a part of a couple. I've had pieces that weren't willing to have that sacrifice, you know?
Yeah, that's crazy.
And to be a group for 10 years, there's everyone's probably had to make some sort of sacrifice.
Squad. You know, and all that stuff.
Yeah, we're still a group too, you know?
Yeah, of course. Yeah.
We're definitely the fucking Wu-Tang, you know?
Yeah. I don't think it's ever going to go away.
We'll never not be the squad.
Of course you'll always be the Monkey House, but... I mean, just being an outsider looking in,
right.
It seems like you guys are kind of doing your own thing right now. And when you do come back together collectively, maybe that'll be like that big album that happens that really brings out the best of you guys, because you did kind of go out and learn yourselves for a little bit.
Absolutely. Absolutely.
Not necessarily new people, but newer.
We're growing along with everything. Yeah. It's fun.
So that's going to be like one of those big, I wouldn't even say reunion, just new albums that when that finally happens,
it's going
to
be a good one.
There's a lot that we can do, and we don't go out of our way to really try to sound like anybody else.
You guys do a great job of that, because you can't compare you guys at all.
Not in the least bit. You know, I think when people see us on stage, that really clicks with them. Whether or not it really will click with them on the record. Not so sure about that.
I remember the first like few shows we played once we had, you know, Scum in It and everything. I remember we got on stage and we got looks from everybody in the audience just like, is this for real? Like, is this actually happening?
And then a minute into it,
everyone's just going crazy and they come up to us after the show.
It's not very often you see 4 people of, you know, pretty much a white complexion.
Yeah.
Up on a stage together doing hip hop music, you know what I mean? I mean, whether I know Steven's Hispanic and
Jimmy.
You know what? I just like found out too what my Indian tribe might be too.
What?
I'm either Coahuila or Juanino.
Damn.
Oh wait, so are you? You are Mexican, right?
I have no fucking clue.
I thought you were like Italian and Hispanic.
So I've got a lot in me. I've got a ton in me, according to my folks. I have at least Greek.
I can see that.
Mexican, quote unquote.
Well,
quote unquote
I mean that's just
Spaniard.
I guess I should have said like Latino or something. Yeah,
Indian or you know.
That's such a
Native American from here.
Such a bigoted term. I'm such a bigot. And,
I'm pretty sure Portuguese, somewhere. I don't know how much
whole bunch of everything from Latin descent, pretty much, and maybe a little bit of indigenous American with some native in you.
Absolutely.
Or...
I would go out of my way to take one of those ancestry tests, but like
I've been considering it.
I don't really know.
I think it'd be cool.
What good it's gonna do though at some point. But I guess family has started like the process to like, you know, see what's up with the Native American side. So we'll see.
Right on, right on. Well, what exactly is going on in the world of St. Even without like a current TMH project going on? Is there a Steven project going on or St. Even project?
Thank you. I like that you said my name too.
Well, I mean, it's
a pleasure.
It's in the damn
absolutely.
Name.
Yeah, no, it really is. Thank you.
Sorry.
Yeah, no, being able to separate somebody from their art, I feel like is a real important part of just existing as an artist. You know, people let things like that destroy them. You know, not being able to separate themselves from their art. So I don't let my art get the best of me, I would say. I'm not going to let it kill me. I'm not going to let it, you know, bring me any sort of agony. I feel like, you know, there's a lot of opportunity to make things better. Always. So.
Yeah, I got a chance to actually see some of Saint's stuff a few weeks ago. And it's something to look forward to, for sure.
So are you working more... as a lyricist as usual, or I know you've been kind of dabbling in the whole production side of it too, because I've seen you messing around with some beat pads on like your iPad and stuff like that. Is that like a big thing you're working on now, is making your own beats? And
I've got so many beats in the cut, like I've got so many beats I'm working on in the cut. There's so much you can do with music, and I would just like hate to like really rush anything. But like I will say, like my big influences besides like hip-hop, I love, you know, I grew up in hip-hop, I love hip-hop, you know, all that's my forte. But my heart belongs to, as well as hip-hop, electronic music. I really, really dig that as a whole. Electronic music has been something that I've just been into for so many years now that I've just like entered like a whole different world. So,
well,
like, I would love to make something like as a tribute to that. You know what I mean?
As a hip hop MC, you kind of have to be anyway, just because if you feel a beat, that's without the lyrics over the beat, that's just electronic music.
Absolutely.
We're making it electronically on the computer. That's kind of where it gets its name from, you know. But
there's a certain ambiance you can create when you're working with like electric instruments. It's really, really cool.
I mean, I never really got into electronic music. I'm really a lyric driven listener when it comes to music. Like I like to listen to the story. If you don't really got anything to say, you don't really, you know, appease to me. And it's hard talking to people about music when I try to tell them how I listen to music, because they're like, oh, you don't like that? I was like, I mean, that it doesn't say anything to me, you know, like, cool, like, it bangs in your car, or cool, you know we could party and drink to that. But I mean, if I don't learn something about the person on the microphone, or you know, here's some story that's either fictional or completely a truth. Like, you know, I like to get that picture painted in my head, you know?
Absolutely. Absolutely. And I think when it comes to that, there's definitely, I hold on to a lot of the original ideals of what hip hop and rap should be. You know, I think a lot of the new shit, or some of the new stuff can be, can be pretty, you know, out there as far as taste goes, and you know, and whatnot, and that's okay. There's a place for this stuff to exist, and you know, it exists
just
for a reason.
Just so you know, say that you don't have to be PC whatsoever on here. You can call it new shit.
You know what? Like, you know, like again, like about like context and stuff.
Yeah, good.
There's different contexts that you can enjoy things in. Like, essentially, I know rap is just talking shit, like the art of talking shit. You know, but there's a certain musicality towards hip hop and rap that I think you need to at least appreciate, you know?
Just what, like, know your history though, you know what I mean?
Yeah.
It's like if you're a star baseball player, you're not going to make it to the major leagues and not know who the fuck like Hank Aaron is, or Babe Ruth, or you know, like Mickey Mantle, Lou Gehrig and people like that are like the you know, forefathers, the greats of the sport, within their big part of the history too. Like, I feel like a lot of these kids, like, who was it? I think it was Lil Yachty who was he said he didn't even listen to Pac and Biggie or something like that, and like he said that they weren't the greatest, but then he went on to say like he didn't even listen to him or something like that. I forget, somebody said something in that sort of extent, but
yeah, I feel like being introduced to all those different artists kind of helps you branch out and kind of do new things.
Yeah, and if you don't bother to do it, I feel like you're robbing yourself of understanding
the culture.
Yeah,
and that's where there's this huge disconnect and people are getting like really aggravated with the fact that it's like hip hop music is split between these old heads and the new wave, and in the new wave is pissed off at the old heads because they're like, oh, you guys are just old and bitter and we're the hot thing now, and you know there's no encouragement from you guys should be helping us keep the music going. And then the old heads are like, you guys are just some fucking overnight SoundCloud sensations, don't know shit about the history and, you know, the upbringing and what the work we put in to this to even make it happen. Time, you know what I mean?
Helping them make it continue on and because it's
that's like never
broken apart so far.
It's never happened before like that, though, I feel, where it's like there's that huge disconnects between the two generations. To where it's almost like two completely different genres now.
Right.
Yeah, that's there's, you know, I think we may be living in a time where we're post-rap, post-hip-hop. Mm. You know, and this is a result.
It's a new genre.
Of all this, you know, it's its own entity. And
it's like a dying breed. It's almost like we need to, like, rename what it is now. Because it's, like, really, is it even hip-hop music anymore? Mm-hmm. Do we even call it rap?
Listening to so many different kinds of music and growing up with it, you can definitely appreciate, you know, you can appreciate a bounce here and there. You know, even haters will nod their head once in a while. There's just a certain trueness to everything that really shines through and will really, like, test a lot of people, you know, depending on whether or not they'll stay around for however long they'll stay. These 6-month career rappers, all sorts of things like that. It happens, though. It happens. You can probably edit that out. that wasn't too wise. I don't want to talk too much shit here. I just wanna, you know, make a bigger point to say that there's a lot of love to be had out there, a lot of love to be shared between people. You know, different people are doing different shit. At all points of history, we've all been kind of doing something different.
Well, a perfect way to segue me into this, St. Even. Speaking of, you know, these artists that are out there in the world today, modern or of all time, let's get into this week's most controversial question on this show, the all-time top 5 MCs of St. Even.
Guess who's back again. Shady's back. Tell a friend. Now everyone report to the dance floor. To the dance floor. To the dance floor. Now everyone report to the dance floor. Alright, stop. Pajama time. Come here, little kitty, on my lap. Guess who's back with a brand new rap? And I don't mean rap as in a new case of child molestation accusation. No worries, Papa's got a brand new bag of toys. What else could I possibly do to make noise? I done touched on everything but little boys. That's not a stab at Michael, that's just a metaphor. I'm just psycho, I go a little bit crazy sometimes. I get a little bit out of control with my rhymes. Good God, Dick, do a little slide. Bend down, touch your toes, and just glide up the center of the dance floor. Like TP for my bunghole, and it's cool if you let one go. Nobody's gonna know who'd hear it. Give a little poot poot, it's okay. My CD just skipped, and everyone just heard you let one rip. Now I'm gonna make you dance, it's your chance. Yeah, boy, shake that ass. Oops, I mean girl, 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 girl.
Girl, you know you're my world.
Alright, now lose it. Just lose it. Go crazy. Oh baby, oh baby, baby.
It's Friday, and it's my day. Just to party, all the way to Sunday. Maybe till Monday, I don't know what day. Every day's just a holiday. Cruising on the freeway, feeling kinda breezy. Get the top down and
my top 5
all time.
So they told me that we'd be going over this like beforehand, of course, you know, because no good radio show or no good podcast or anything like that.
We're not gonna let you go in straight blind.
Yeah, you know, get just a little bit of lubrication before that, you know. But there's so many different ways to answer this question. You know, everybody's gonna have their own like different subjective thing. And I'll probably give, I'll be completely honest, I'll probably give you like the safest answer that I could probably even think of. Because it's true. You know, like there's really no way around like the way that I would like measure this talent. You know what I mean? I'd say top five, starting with like...
It doesn't have to be in a specific order.
Oh, like any specific order like that?
No, it just has to be five, who you like, feel they are.
Five MCs that I really appreciate, that I've really just come to, you know, have as a cornerstone of my life and just really keep referring back to as far as their wisdom on wax goes. I would say one of them is obviously Tupac Shakur. Like, obviously. You know, his spirit as a revolutionary and just showing us, you know, showing so many different people that you could still be hard and still be, you know, as gentle as you want to be.
And
you know,
still
you
can be a beautiful intellectual,
real poetic
type of person. A multifaceted person. It's very, very possible. And Tupac really showed that no matter who you are, you know, you can make some sort of difference. But he was hard as fuck, man.
He was.
And he did it with a nose ring. Fucking hard. Yeah, he did it with a nose ring.
He did it with a fucking nose ring.
That spirit and that charisma, I feel like every man should like aspire to, you know, just be on that level. You know what I mean? Cracking up with another beer.
It's beers in the air.
Yeah. No, I do. I do need another beer at this point.
You want
point.
To shoot or?
Come yeah, on. Absolutely. Yeah.
These ones pretty good.
But no. So obviously, Pac. He's just got that spirit of a revolutionary. Made me want to do something. His voice and the way he commanded on his records, that charisma, that just, you know, that gut and fucking, when you're listening to Tupac, you know you're listening to Tupac because you feel it. You feel
yeah,
that
he,
shit,
he's one
know?
Of those guys that just makes you go, oh, yeah, man, he just,
I was at work the other day and heard somebody just bumping Tupac for like 3 hours and I was like, fuck yeah. You know what I mean? It's just Pac, yeah, you know, bugged out.
Listening
you know?
To Pac turns you into the hype man. Skit of Key and Peele. I don't know if you guys have seen that, but like when he's like, that's like when Pac's really going in. That's how it makes you feel, man.
You know, and that's an important trait to me when I feel when I feel like listening to music or you know listening to rappers or artists and whatnot. If you can make me feel you've done your job.
Yes.
You know, another MC that I'd say that I'd have in my top five of all time. This is probably like not where I would say it's like safe, maybe where it gets a little bit controversial. Now it's Andre 3000.
And this is the third week in a row we've had an Andre 3000 in the top five.
But I feel like I can really like tell you why I really fuck with him. Is throughout his entire career, I don't feel like he's spit one whack verse.
There's honestly not enough of them out there.
The entire way.
But then again, we're not oversaturated with somebody. But if you've been that sort of person and you've released so much that's been so good,
absolutely,
to where like we want more. You know, it's not to the state where Eminem's kind of gone, where we're really oversaturated with Eminem, and it's like we could have lived without a lot of it at this point. But Andre,
that's true.
Andre
like,
3
you know,
stacks.
That's true. Like at some point. But you know what, 3 Stacks, to me, I feel like he's been able to really control his career on his own terms, you know, really, really find out what and how much his voice is worth, you know, who he is as a person, what he really wants to say. I believe he's a man who really understands his influence on other people and what he says actually affects other people. You know, that's something really big in life. I feel at least we should learn to you know get our point across clear to everybody else. You know, he does it in a really complex way sometimes, but I feel like if you listen to him enough, you know, it'll get it across no problem. You know, but he's been able to, you know, like I said, live through his career on his own terms, and I feel like at this point he may sort of be in retirement, as a matter of fact, and he only does a verse every now and again to you know just. Write another page or write another paragraph and you know his book and whatnot, but he did it.
I think I saw him pop up recently on that NERD album. He was on the new one.
And it's only, you know, it's always classic shit with Andre 3000. I've never heard a verse where I didn't like appreciate what he was trying to do artistically.
My absolute favorite Andre verse is his verse on International Players.
I was just about, yeah.
Like, dude, like, he, that guy made me want to get married. With, like, you know what I mean? Like, it's usually not every dude's like, oh, I want to go get married. But, like, man,
like,
he made giving up your manhood, like, not manhood, but, you know,
your bachelor
card, you know, being a player. He made giving up being a player sound so great with the way he talked about.
And, like, he segued, like, into the song so well, I feel, with that verse. Because it was kind of like, it was just on the introduction part where there was no, like, bass and everything.
Yeah.
And
it it's
pure technical skill. Yeah, Andre 3000 is second to none. Yeah, second to none as far as technical skill goes. He's can't be touched, seriously. The way he weaves and bobs out of these stanzas, it's on another fucking planet. You know, I just I hope that we're going to get one more Outkast album and one more Andre 3000 album. But I will say this, I don't think it's going to happen.
Have they released an album since the...
Not since Idlewild. And you know what? I feel like they left everything on such... They tied a bow around everything pretty nicely with Idlewild, their last album, and that was that. You know, they understood that. I think they saw where music was going, and they were like, well, you know, we can do our musical and bow out.
Yeah,
you know?
I mean,
like, let's do our musical and bow out like classic gentlemen.
Sometimes you just got to know when your time's up, mm-hmm. you know? It's like, I feel that way right now. It's just like, of course, I make music for me. You know, so it's not too big of a deal, but it's also like, I don't want to be the only one listening to my words. You know, I'm putting it out there so that I could share what I have to say to other people. But I feel like the style of music I make is a dying breed, and like, our time is up.
You know, I feel like there's always going to be somebody around to appreciate it, though. Life is long. Life is a very, very long experience for everybody, and I do feel like things come back in cycles. You know, lyricism and, you know, coming from a first-person perspective and actually having some sort of, you know, background behind it and not just having it be shallow or, you know, hollow words just that mean nothing. It's something, you know...
Like, no context whatsoever.
Absolutely. Yeah. You know, that has its place in this world, and I don't feel like it ever loses its importance. You know, somebody's gonna pick that up one day and appreciate it for what it is. And I feel that makes, you know, making it worth it.
Yeah.
You know, like, I feel like Andre 3000, he might understand that.
So, I mean, maybe years down the road, we just get that last reunion album before they really hang it up. And
I don't really know. I would say if they stopped it where they stopped it, because the last song in their album, Idlewild, is just a song called A Bad Note, which is basically a crazy-ass thrash guitar, like death metal thrash guitar, over fucking ominous ass piano for like 12 minutes, and they just loop that shit out. You know, they keep going, jamming on that shit, and then it's over. The song is called A Bad Note, and they ended their album,
like,
which ended their careers.
It's
basically
just straight like an instrumental write out of the album,
and it's called A Bad Note. So they ended on a bad note. And like, if they never make another album again, that's the illest shit ever. You know what I mean? Like, they had, you know, their own plan with it, and they just sort of like, it's kind of like, you know, you have your, think of like an evil villain who, you know, controls the whole town, but he's got to hide his machine that's like getting people like hypnotized and shit before he, you know, he joins the real world again so people don't, you know, know. You know, that he's guilty of all this shit. That's what Outkast did, basically. They destroyed their own machine so that nobody would be able to use it again. Not even themselves. That's fucking awesome, you know, to have that much control over your art. That's a beautiful thing. That's a beautiful thing. And if they want to come back, I'll be really happy. But if they don't, I'll be satisfied. Like, I'll be satisfied. They used to keep me up at night wondering if Outkast would come back, just because I felt like a lot of shit was so hollow. But then I realized, the reason they made stuff in the first place was to, you know, really show what it's like as them as individuals. And, you know, you carry that idea with you as an artist. You know, hey, I can do this too. I can live in my own context. I could, you know, have my own 20 years and everything. You know, I could live a lifetime in just about 3 or 4 minutes, you know, these songs.
Right on. So we got we've got Tupac Shakur and Andre 3000, and I love and appreciate
the fact that he's going
the fact that he gives you the great detail. Yeah. It's not just like I'm gonna hotshot these and just pick the five that I think everyone's gonna agree with.
Okay, so what did Dylan say? I want to know what Dylan said.
there was no sane even explanation behind each one. There was just a five and then him disagreeing with everyone else's five. That's pretty much what it was. You know, classic scum. But he said Big L, Maxo Cream, Lord Finesse. All right.
Lord Finesse.
Fuck, who else?
Did he say Tupac or Biggie?
Did he say Wayne?
No, I think he might have said Biggie.
Yeah, I think he was Biggie and Justice Tupac.
Tell me he said Lil Wayne.
Or like vice versa. I don't know.
Did he say Lil Wayne?
No, he didn't.
We talked about that after the fact.
he brought up the fact that nobody picked Lil Wayne.
Yeah.
But I mean, like, you can't get mad when you were the one of the people picking. You know, you didn't put him up there. Anyway,
all right.
I'll send you the link to episode 2.
Yeah, please do. I'll give it. I'm always entertained.
It's a great
episode. By Dylan's answers.
And if you guys missed episode 2 with Bel Air Boys. Great episode. You can go listen to Dylan Drugg's top five and go tell him he's out of his fucking mind in the comments if you want.
You know what? I might need to see that like right away. We'll go on break and I'm gonna need to see that.
go into the comments and tell him nah, or go tell him you love it. Who knows? So we got Tupac Shakur,
Andre 3000.
Who's number 3?
I would say, and you know, I know we were just literally just talking about him and discounted him, but Shady, Eminem, I would say easily in my fucking.
It's an all time, and he's another one that's been mentioned all 3 weeks.
Yeah.
And it's whether he's kind of past his prime was his prime. You know what I mean? Yeah. And you know, maybe his music now is for people. It definitely wasn't what I listened to the guy for. You know.
You know, if there's anything that I can say about Lil Wayne, it's all of his music really ages so finely. So finely. You know, again, with the context thing, I'll hear him spit a verse on Monday and then hear him spit it again on Friday and hear something completely different about it. And it'll just blow my fucking mind. Wayne is all over the place as far as freeform rhyme goes. He is that man. He is rhyme. In its human form. If there's anything I can say about him, he really gets my imagination going as far as, you know, because I'm not just listening to, I feel like when I listen to Wayne, I'm not just like listening to what he has to say. I'm really like living it and like going off of what he's saying and going off of my own little brain tangents on, you know, like the points that he's bringing up and the things that he's saying. I could end up thinking about something completely different to what he's going off on for.
So would,
you know, the
would you say Wayne is maybe your number 4? Or?
I would absolutely say that Wayne is one of them.
So
what the fuck are we talking about?
Because I heard Shay and then we kind of broke off.
Is the great, that's the what, great that's part about these interviews, beers in the air, is because we legitimately just sit here, have this interview while we're drinking a 6-pack of beer. So it's so easy to just be like, so where the fuck are we talking about?
Nah, but Shady. So back to Shady. Back to Eminem, Marshall Mathers. I feel like he's had so much influence on who I am as a person, just with attitude-wise and, you know, having or knowing what's important to me in particular and really applying it to, you know, just how I go about life. You know what I mean? Like, in his lyrics, it was always, always so personal. It was always from the gut, always from a place of, like, uncertainty. And
that's the thing, too. Like, even with his new album, even though I personally wasn't a big fan of it, you could still tell, like, that shit is...
That motherfucker,
you know, from
spit.
The heart.
Like, yeah, you know what I mean? At the end of the day, yeah,
I think his issue is getting in with the wrong production team.
Yeah, like wrong production.
I don't know. Is he not working with Dre anymore?
I don't think I feel like for the last two albums, he didn't work with Dre on the production.
He's, I feel like that's had a bunch of different producers on yeah. these albums. Yeah, Alex the Kid being, you know, mainly one of them. I think he has a real good idea of who in particular he appeals to yeah. as well.
Mm-hmm.
I could go, like, you know, a bit deeper into, like, what that really means or whatnot, but it really doesn't mean too much. Because he's for the culture at the end of the day.
Yeah.
You know, I see him out there fucking trying
to... No, because it's not like he completely lost his talent and he sucks, because he'll still get on and drop a freestyle and you're like, bro, that Whoa. Was better than your last Whoa. Album. Yeah. Like, you know, what happened?
But, yeah, it's funny because I know always of the... there's always that meme going around about Eminem's music being for Call of Duty players who drink Mountain Dew and, you know, like, support their troops and shit. Like, that's you know, that's who people try to make Eminem's music out to be for. And that's whatever. Like, okay, that's, you know, that's fine. They're, you know, that's got some truth to it and whatnot. But
that's funny, but I don't know how to... how I can agree with that, just because, like, what Eminem are you referring to?
This,
because
the Eminem that I'm referring
I know
to
and
is...
I've listened to,
I think it's like his like, was... on the Marshall Mathers LP 2, he had that song with Rihanna,
or like the Relapse or shit, yeah. you know, the real weird accented stuff.
Kinda. Yeah, see,
you know what, Eminem show, Encore, Recovery, yeah. Relapse. All that shit.
That was all still
all that
fucking
shit.
Cool.
It catered to a lot of different people.
Yeah, a
whole entire spectrum of people.
And it comes back to what we were talking about earlier, how it's Eminem, but it's a different Eminem every time.
Yeah, absolutely.
And that's how you should be as an artist. You're presenting a brand new collection of yourself. And, I mean, sometimes it's not going to be for everybody. I liked pretty much everything he did all the way up until Relapse.
Well, no, it was weird because... When he started with the Slim, so he had the, you know, I know he had that Infinite before he got signed and everything.
Did you ever listen to Infinite?
Oh, it was awesome, dude. I thought it was super cool.
Really?
Because I know all his songs were made. I remember he said that, like, he made those songs to be played on the radio. I think they were, like, a little more mellow than what sort of appeared
That's
on
rock
the Slim
bottom.
Shady LP. Yeah. But, He always dropped those albums in doubles. You know, he had the Slim Shady LP and the Marshall Mathers LP. He had the Eminem Show, and was it Encore?
Encore after that, yeah.
What was the, oh, I Curtain fucking, Call was the
I will say record. Though, even
Curtain
though,
Call was like an EP though, wasn't it?
No, it was like it was like his greatest hits, kind of.
Yeah, that was his, oh, okay. that was his greatest.
But hit. He always did those doubles. So it was that, and then he did Relapse and Recovery, and then he dropped the Marshall Mathers LP 2. And then Revival, which had nothing to do with one another.
I need to interject because I really need to say that I fucking did not like Encore, like, in the least bit. Like, seriously, I did not. Oh, you know what? Yeah. No, that fucking song, Just Lose It, is amazing. That song is amazing.
Oh, but, yeah.
He was, I know that.
I like to ask
document,
like that.
Pretty
like
well
that
documented that he was heavily
Was Just
on
Lose
drugs.
It the one where he does that weird, like, Pee Wee Herman voice?
Ah.
Yeah, okay. Yeah.
That shit was hard. Yeah. Like, I think he really didn't give a fuck when he made that. But he was so heavily on drugs yeah. during yeah. that album that it was just not.
Well,
he
even says, like,
I fell off
in,
on Eminem at that
there
point.
There was a song where he says he wanted to throw away.
Well, in Recovery, on what's the song? His first, like, big single from Recovery,
Crack a Bottle?
No,
that was...
No, Crack a Ball wasn't Recovers.
Oh, yeah, no. What
but Recovery was the one with...
The
I'm not afraid.
Yeah, there you go. Exactly that song. I'm not afraid. Where he says, perhaps I ran the maxes into the ground, but I'm not going to go back to that now. You know, like, he pretty much says in his songs, he's like, yeah.
He whipped his own ass, yeah.
Yeah.
Yeah, that shit was corny. I'm not going to do that again. I'm sorry. He owned it.
Yeah, you know what? No, I thought that shit was hard as fuck. I don't give a shit what anybody says about that part of him, that Relapse part of him. That shit was hard as fuck. I still bump Relapse to this day. Relapse
it's 3 a.m. in the morning.
Relapse was the hardest fucking shit.
Relapse
and that's what I want from Eminem. I don't want him to fucking... I don't want him to go soft. I want him to spit some hard-ass shit that's going to make me like, well, I don't do black music. I don't do white music.
I do fight music.
That shit was so fucking hard, yo. Bring me back to that. There's a rage. There's a rage that he developed in me that I don't feel like he's been, like, nurturing in the way... in the way that he should be. Nurturing in the way that he should be. He lit a fire in me and... I feel like he's been fanning the flames for years, but I would love him to fan the flames even more. Like, and you know what? I will say, though, that I haven't really given his newest album, The Fairest Chance yet, but
I haven't either.
This is the way life works.
You know either, but I'm the type of person where if you don't grab me with the first couple songs, and I don't kind of feel some promise, I'm like, ugh.
Yeah.
I'll push it off.
Yeah, because the first song on his album was that Walk on Water, I think, with Beyonce. And what he
rapped his ass off.
No, he did.
He always rapped his ass off. I feel like he's just so frustrated because he does not know. He can do anything, but he does not know what to do.
Well, back to what I was saying about his production team, it's like who's putting it together and telling and putting it, you know, being the driving force to let him know that this flow style, why don't you get into a more shady flow style? Yeah. You know what I mean? But like, why does it sound so much more robotic forced?
That's been my biggest problem with his last two albums.
I wonder if his albums aren't pressed analog anymore, or whatever. It's all digital now. If it's all digital.
Most are. It depends on the studio you go to, but
I would not. Well, you know what? I would be shocked to hear if it was all digital now with Eminem.
But it's also just the way he's delivering.
Yeah, exactly.
It's like, feels like it's forced. I don't know. It's like forced, and he's kind of
feels like he's being too controlled. Maybe in his older age, he's kind of just gone into the studio and taken direction more than getting in there and kind of owning his
definitely
piece of work.
Have heard that he's like a control freak when it comes to that. He really doesn't respond to criticism well, and whatever I know that at this point in his career, whatever he drops is going to sell.
Oh,
and that's okay
sure.
with me.
Yeah,
that's okay.
And
with me.
I'm sure he knows it too.
Yeah,
that's,
you know,
that
as long as he's
repping
for the culture and shit, and
that'd
saying
be a real shame to
thing.
Know if what he does now is kind of just a cash grab.
Yeah,
type deal. It's like, oh, don't do that to us, man. We thought like you were the guy that wasn't that. You know,
absolutely. But, yeah, people. Life is long. Life is
even
long.
Like you know, past couple weeks. If you're an Eminem fan, you probably fucking hate me by now because I keep bringing up the fact that it's just not what it used to be, and because it's not, and it's not that contextually it isn't. It's just it doesn't sound good to me anymore. Yeah. Like it's not like he's bad.
Yeah.
It's not like he's the bad
one.
It's just it's not.
The only thing that I can say to at least salvage that, because I feel that too to a degree. When I'm 40 years old, and some time has passed, and I don't know how long Eminem's gonna be alive. straight up, I don't know how long Eminem's gonna be alive. But I know when I'm an old man and whatnot, and I hear his records come on, and I don't know if my MP3s or you know my FLAC files degraded or whatever at that point, or
this guy
I'm gonna have to be subjected to listening to Apple Music and their low ass fucking bitrate or all the time or any other damn fucking man. Streaming music sucks. I will say that streaming music is balls. I hate that
I don't like it, dude.
It's fucking like it. It's the worst. It's ass, yo. I fucking hate streaming music. Fuck streaming music.
It's cool.
What's your deal with streaming music?
I can hear the difference. I've listened to you're on the same level as far as this goes. I listen to so much shit from ripped off of like CDs in the highest quality that I can get it, that I can hear at least, you know, like the smallest change in a bit rate, and it like fucks with me. I don't like that. It's the worst shit ever.
Yeah,
and
that's why
I always like
buying CDs. Yeah, it's hard to find them, but
listening to shit at like 32 or 64 compared to like a really really low like 1440 or something is like it's. To the trained ear, it's like, man, it sounds so much cleaner, like the dynamic range and just like less compressed and all that. But like when the reason I don't really mind streaming music is because it's usually in my Civic, which is my sound system in there is a piece of shit.
Yeah.
So I take what I get in there, or I'm at work and I use some shitty little speaker that I plug into my phone and I've got unlimited motherfucking data, so I stream the shit out of like album. Like I've got so much music on my Apple Music right now that it's I don't even know what to do with. Like there's a song.
You should follow me on Apple Music, by the way.
How does that work?
So you just like set up your little account and
Oh, so you like have like playlists that you make, and I can
follow Sane even on the Apple Music.
That's the only thing that I can like say testament as far as streaming music goes. But I was still talking about Eminem when I mentioned streaming, right?
Yeah.
Okay, so he's gonna do well streaming wise, and there's an incentive to all that, you know. But it's my FLAC files. That's what I was mentioning. When they all sound dated and whatnot. When all that's said and done, if I'm spinning dusty ass Eminem vinyl, I know it's gonna sound different. I know it's gonna hit me in a completely different way, because life is long again. I feel like shit's different on Monday than it is on Sunday.
Mm-hmm.
Always, life is long. There's a lot to learn from it. I just hope I hope when I go back to listen to Eminem that it doesn't piss me off too much, because some of it does piss me off, but I. Consistency, you know, consistency. He's a goofball, you know what I mean? Like, at the end of the day, he's a goofball, and he hasn't really done anything to go out of his way to be bad to anybody. You know, his music might not click with me 100% of the time, but I appreciate
at the end
that
of
he's
the
for the culture. Yeah. I appreciate that he's for
the at
culture.
The end of the day, though, he's not making it for you.
Yeah, no,
you know?
He's hella not.
It's
fuck no. And that's okay, because, like, well, you know what I mean? You could, like, I guess, get in tune with that, maybe, if you want to. That's up to you. That's completely up to you.
Yeah, you know, like, I mean, at the end of the day, he's making music for himself.
Mm-hmm.
You know, it's because he's got the last call, I'm sure. If he liked that track and he wanted to put it on his album, there's a reason it's there. And if you don't like it, Eminem says, fuck you, you know, probably. But, you know, as a fan, though, as somebody that's been very supportive over the years, you almost feel like you have a little bit of a say, you know. I think that's why we get a little overcritical on our artists.
I feel like he really hasn't even gotten started yet. Yeah, like, the time has passed by so quickly for Eminem that he's really on the spot and really grasping for straws. I feel like he's one project away from being just fucking out there again.
That would be...
just one project away. And
that'd be a hell of a world
career.
If we come full circle from...
He knows his career is like that. I'm sure he knows his career is... You know, I can take time doing this shit. You know, it's not like I'm going to fall off tomorrow. You know,
he's also one of those guys I feel like can disappear for a while, and then all of a sudden...
Just come back.
Come back on a feature of a song, and you see him in a music video with, like, long gray hair and a beard, and he's just dropping some crazy Eminem shit, and you're just like, whoa, where the fuck did Eminem come from?
Could you imagine Eminem with gray-ass hair? He'll do it.
We'll get there one day,
though,
you know?
I have full faith in Eminem for what's to come.
But... Yeah, so we've got Tupac, we've got Andre 3 Stacks, we kind of jumped ahead a little bit and said Lil Wayne for number 4, and we went back and went in depth with number 3 at Shady. Who is number 5?
Before I jump into number 5 right away, I will say, though, number 4 is Lil Wayne, like, definitively number 4, Lil Wayne. You know, high and mighty, like, all the way, Lil Wayne. My number 5 MC, Jay-Z. Ooh. For, I don't think any reason that, you know, people aren't already too familiar with. He's touched a lot of people in a lot of different ways. Did you guys hear his last album?
The 444?
Mm-hmm.
Oh, yeah.
I'm not too into Jay-Z, and then my life sucks because, like, I can never catch a break. Not too into the guy, and I catch heat, like, oh, how the fuck do you not like Jay-Z? Like, what do you like if you think he's whack? Like, just because I don't like someone doesn't make them whack. Like, I've had this conversation with, like, you before, or I think Jimmy as well. With, like, Yellow Wolf, they're like, oh, you don't like Yellow Wolf? How do you don't like Yellow Wolf? Just not for me. Not
Yellow
for
Wolf.
Me. Like, Jay-Z, not for me. Do I think he sucks? No, because I just listened to a fucking Jay-Z song the other day where he fucking absolutely bodied some motherfuckers. You probably know what's that song where he's talking about, like, Rockefeller and shit like that, and how they're out there.
All of them.
Oh, dude, he fucking bodied everybody that he mentioned in that song, and I was like, God damn! It was the first time I ever heard that Jay-Z song, and I was like, whoa, this motherfucker's ripping him. Like, I think he told Nas, he's like, He's like, oh, you got something an Illmatic. That's like two albums every 10 years.
Two hot album every 10 year average. Smarten up, Nas.
Yeah,
I love Nas for what it's worth. Fucking Jay-Z is just way too witty, man. He'll get away with saying some shit that won't even hit you until like weeks later. I'll be thinking of random lyrics will pop into my head throughout the day, and it'll be Jay-Z. I'm like, holy crap, he said that. He really went in depth and said that. But the reason I say Jay-Z though is the first album that I ever owned, like to myself for sure, was Jay-Z's Volume 2 Hard Knock Life. That was the first album that I'd ever been given, like as my own, to like really sit down and listen to.
On a side note, you all know the first album I ever bought was R. Kelly's The Chocolate Factory.
That's fucking awesome.
Can I tell you guys mine now?
That is amazing.
I bought that album and only listened to Ignition Remix. I didn't listen to anything else, you know, on the CD.
Visit it again. I really fuck with that.
So my first album that I ever bought,
music at least,
I ever bought was a Nickelodeon soundtrack.
Nice.
I like Angry Beavers and Rugrats.
Nice. No, that's awesome.
It was between that and Spice Girls.
They had some pretty good music on those soundtracks.
Yes.
Spice Girls too. Yeah, I got started young as far as music goes. Shit, I remember being in my living room and hearing my dad play Real Motherfucking G's by Easy. Like back when the beef was happening and shit. You know, motherfuck Dre, motherfuck Snoop, motherfuck Death Row. Before I even knew what it meant. I'm like growing up, and when it clicked, I was like, oh shit, they were beefing and I was singing the beef record. You know, that shit was fucking awesome. But with Jay-Z, first album that was ever really mine, I don't know how I came across it. I think I might have like bugged my mom to get it because that fucking song was on it.
It's a hard night.
Well, that one too, obviously. that was a secondary draw. But the first one was Can I Hit It in the Morning Without Giving You Half of My Dough? And even worse, if I was broke, would you want me? If I could. Yeah, that shit was. What's the fucking song called? You know what it's called.
If you're a Jay-Z fan, you know.
Yeah, if you're a Jay-Z fan, you know what the fucking song's called. That shit was so hard to me, though. I remember seeing the fucking music video on TV. You know, I think it had shots of Rush Hour in it, right? Like, if I'm not mistaken, yeah, and Ja Rule was in it too. And Amir,
Ja Rule,
that shit was fucking hard. That song is so hard. Every time that song comes on, I'm just, you know, taken to another different level. That's when rap actually meant something.
Late,
you know?
90s, early 2000s music. Fuck.
So good, dude.
Yeah, it took me away. But listen, if you guys get a chance, listen to that fucking album in particular. I feel like Jay-Z really embraces his mystique entirely on that one. And like just tells all sorts of different mafia tales of just like crazy shit. It's like watching a movie when you're listening to
it. Did you ever read a Jay-Z's Decoded, that book that he came out with?
Yeah, bits and pieces of it.
Dude,
yeah.
It's crazy reading it because he takes certain songs from his albums.
Absolutely.
And just kind of breaks it down and tells full on stories as to, you know,
his music. It's cool. Yeah, absolutely. As a supplement to all that. Man, but I feel like he planted a real big seed in me of like, okay, this is what you're capable of, and you can do that too. You know what I mean? This is what, so you know, this is all of myself. His music really gave me the idea that, huge inspiration on me is Jay-Z. You know, he was all of himself. You know, he was never really nothing but Jay-Z, and there was never really no question as to who Jay-Z was. He was just Jay-Z. Like, nobody was ever like, what does Jay-Z mean? No, he was just Jay-Z. That's, you know, that jazzy motherfucker. Like, that's what I, at least the origin story that I've heard from his name is, he's that jazzy motherfucker. Mm-hmm. You know what I mean? Jazzy guy. Jay-Z.
Cool.
But
cool,
he's cool. He's the best, man. Jay-Z's fucking awesome. Listen to his music. Put it on shuffle. Let it hit you. You know, you'll see. I think it'll click with you one day if you're not too big into him right now.
Well, I mean, I don't hate the guy. I've heard his songs before. I've definitely jammed them before, like in high school. I used to play that New York song all the time.
Oh yeah.
Oh yeah. No, you know that
album. Him and Alicia Keys.
He's had such a long, awesome, interesting career. The all sorts of different variations of production on his albums has been insane. Just listen. I have every single one of his studio albums on my phone, like all on me at all times. So I can go in and like listen to, hey, you know, I can listen to Baroque Jay-Z or listen to like Eurotrash centric Jay-Z. You know what I mean? Like appealing to like those sort of people, like really classy Jay-Z, really thugged out Jay-Z, really fucking minimalist Jay-Z.
Yeah, he definitely took different routes with all of his albums.
Yeah, absolutely.
Sure. It's crazy, like, because it's usually all about like, the team that you're working with when you're putting the album together that helps create that different vibe.
Sound, yeah.
Because, like I could tell, like, that, what was that, Blueprint 2, I think? Was that had that song on it?
Blueprint 3.
Blueprint 3, okay. So, I mean, it production-wise, I think that was a great-sounding album. Like, I mean, I've never been too big on him, you know what I mean? He's never been one of, like, my favorites. But it's not like I'm like, fuck Jay-Z, I'll never listen to that
fuck
bullshit.
Fuck Jay-Z.
You know,
it's like you respect him as an artist. And
he's doing
stuff.
His thing.
Yeah.
He's been around, and like even in that New York song, like he paints this picture of New York. I've never been there, but like the way he's like with what he's talking about, I'm like picturing New York from what I know of it, like of what he's
pictures
doing.
Pictures and movies and yeah. stuff. And...
You know, just sitting courtside at the Knicks game and shit like that, or Nets game, whatever one he said. but. You know, like he paints that picture for me, and I've never been to New York, so that's kind of like a little journey through it.
And that goes back to what you were talking about, like when we first started the show today, about, you know, how you like to listen to those songs with lyrics because it tells a story, and you're able
yeah,
to
exactly,
kind of step
exactly.
in the shoes of.
And not all of Jay-Z's songs do that, but right. there he does have some songs that'll do that for me, and I've listened to them, just like when I told you. I didn't know the name of that song, and I'd never heard it before, but he absolutely fucking put everybody that he was talking yeah. about in a body bag, and I was like, damn, that guy.
Yeah, there's a reason they call him Hov.
So, I typed a text to a girl I used to see, saying that I chose this cutie pie with whom I want to be, and I apologize if this message gets you down, then I CC'd every girl that I'd CC round town, and hate to see y'all frown, but I'd rather see her smiling, witness all around me, true, but I'm no island, peninsula maybe, makes no sense, I know crazy, give up all this pussycat that's in my lap, no looking back, spaceships. Don't come equipped with rearview mirrors. They dip as quick as they can. The atmosphere is now ripped. I'm so like a pimp. I'm glad it's night. So the light from the sun would not burn me on my bum when I shoot the moon. High jump the broom like a preemie out the womb. My partner yelling too soon. Don't do it. Reconsider. Read some litter. Sure on the subject. You sure? Fuck it. You know we got your back like chiropractic. If that bitch do you dirty, we'll wipe her ass out as in detergent. Now hurry, hurry, go on to the altar. I know you ain't a pimp, but pimp, remember what I taught you. Keep your heart, three stacks. Keep your heart, hey, keep your heart, three stacks. Keep your heart, man, these girls are smart. Three stacks, these girls are smart. Play your part, play your part.
My bitch a choose it, lover, never fuck without a rubber. Never in the sheets like it on top of the cover. Drive a compressor, top notch hoes get the most, not the lesser. Trash like the fuck for $40 in the club. Fucking up the game, bitch, it gets no love. She be cross country giving all that she got. $1,000 a pop, I'm pulling Bentleys off the lot. I smashed up the gray one, bought me a red. Every time we hit the parking lot, we turn head. Some hoes wanna choose, but them bitches too scary. Your bitch chose me, you ain't a pimp, you a fairy.
Time to get down with the team. The grass is greener on that other side. If you know what I mean, I show you shit you've never seen. The seven wonders of the world. And I can make you the eighth if you wanna be my girl. When I say my girl, I don't mean my woman. That ain't my style. Need a real street stalker. Walk a green mile. You piling up the paper on the dining room table. Cause you able to realize I'm the truth and not a fable. We rockin' Russian sable. Keep that chiller on the rack. What I look like with $1,000 shit up on my back. I'm a $1 million Mac, they need a $1 billion bitch. Put my pimpin' in your life, watch your daddy get rich. Easy as ABC, simple as 1, 2, 3. Get down with UGK, Pimp CB, you with me. Cause what's a hoe with no pimp, and what's a pimp with no hoes? Don't be a lame, you know the game and how it goes. We try to get chose.
decisions with precision. I pick or make my selection on who I choose to be with. Girl, don't touch my protection. I know you want it to slip, but slipping is something I don't do. Tipping for life. That's like making it rain every month on schedule. Let me tell you, get your parasol umbrella, cause it's gonna get wetter. Better prepare you for the sea support. She's supposed to spend it on that baby, but we see she don't.
Ass Paul McCartney. The lawyers couldn't stop this. Slaughter of them pockets had to tie to a rocket.
Send her into outer space. I know he wish he could, cause he paying 20k a day. That bitch is eating good. Like an infant on a double D titty, just getting drunk, cause you miscalculated the next to the last pump.
Dump in the gut, raw from the giddy. Yep, better choose the right one or pick the kitties up. So.
It's a very interesting world. We could all do such little shit too to make it better for each other. And you know, like, for instance, like, speaking of like fuckery and, you know, all sorts of things that we're gonna speak on, today I was out taking a walk and had my hood on, and this little redhead kid on his bike was like,
of course, those little fuckers.
So gingers, man. Well, you know, I was walking down the street in which this kid resided on. But me having my hood on must have like raised a real big red flag for this kid, because when he got like closer to his place, he was playing basketball with some other kids. And I was just in my phone listening to my music, playing Pokemon Go and shit, trying to get my little mileage in, you know, getting my stretching my legs and, you know, which is really important, you know, health and all that shit's really, really important. You know, health first, you know, before anything else, health first. That's what I learned along the way too. Just, take care of yourself as much as possible. Health first. You can really, really slip into something bad, like really, really quickly. You know, that's something that I had to learn for myself. But anyway, I'm walking down the street and this little kid, I guess he's bothered by my presence or whatever. So when he gets closer to the basketball court, and I'm like trying to like not make eye contact, because I will say, like, as a man, like, having to be alive today and shit, you got to be careful fucking doing anything, you know, involving anybody, but like around anybody in particular with kids, it's very important that you demonstrate to them, you know, like, hey, you're not a piece of shit. Or for me, like, you can demonstrate to them that you're not a piece of shit and that you're not going to be a piece of shit to them, no matter, you know, what happens. So I pass by this kid and he gets brave and he just says out of nowhere, he's like, what are you looking at? And I'm like, morning, guys. And, you know, I just left it at that and, you know, walked away.
Little fucker, but man.
Like, what are you looking at? You know, why? Why did that even have to, like, you know, and like, he was expecting me to fly off the handle and, you know, feed into like that ignorance and whatnot.
Feed into his little.
And I'm not going to do that just because it's an option, you know?
First of all, in pure fuckery is where we drop the filters and we let it all out and we tell these crazy stories in depth to the point to where, like, you love it, you hate it, whatever. Fuck that kid. Yeah. Fuck that little kid, like, man. He's lucky. He's lucky it was you walking.
What did I do? What did I really do to that kid? You know, and I said,
I told him to shut his fucking mouth.
They like laughed after it, and it's like, I don't know. If you can demonstrate, at least one person can demonstrate to that kid that not every single person you see walking by is a fucking dickhead, maybe he can hold his tongue the next time he wants to deal with somebody who's going to do something really bad about it.
Well, we also live in a society that's so... Little kids are pieces of shit, man. It's not even... You should be worrying about which little kid's a piece of shit. Because, dude, the generation that's grown up, they're fucked. Absolutely. They're so fucked. Like, all right, I'm a gamer. I play some Xbox. I play online. And I'm playing mature video games in which little fuckers shouldn't be on. But still, we got parents that use a gaming console as a babysitter still these days. And We got little fucking little Timmy over here on Xbox. Little Timmy over here on Xbox. Talk about how he eats way more pussy than I am. But I can't even tell if I'm talking to like some little girl or like a 6-year-old boy on Xbox. It's like, dude, your voice is you're
really high pitched.
Your testicles are still up in your throat. You know, you're talking bad shit, and I don't want to be the one subjected to fucking sitting here getting in a roast off with like a 6, 7, 8, 10-year-old, whatever they are. But they're out there, and that's how kids are, and that's the way they're growing up these days.
Well, the difference between what they're going through now, the kids these days are going through now, and what we went through when we were growing up, I should say, is there's access for everybody to see them fucking up.
Mm-hmm.
You know, I was ratchet as shit and ignorant as fuck, but it was in private.
Exactly.
You know, yeah. Like,
now it's
in private. You know,
blasted all over the internet.
You know? But I made my mistakes, and they weren't permanent.
Yeah.
You know, and these kids don't have that, and they...
And that's the crazy thing, too, with nowadays, like, there's a whole new area of bullying. You know, it's
cyberbullying.
Yeah,
yeah.
Like that.
As far as cyberbullying goes and whatnot,
crazy.
Aye. There's so many issues that fall into the mental health umbrella. That
like as a kid, us growing up, there was bullying. There was getting out there where somebody's picking on you. You take your licks and you kind of grow from it. But now it's like.
I mean, who would bully Ziggy Brown?
Now we got kids getting on Facebook, being complete fucking assholes, or now we've got trolls, man. That's what we call them. Trolls are other like internet instigators, aka trolls.
Instigators.
And I'm guilty of it. I'm a huge troll. I go on Instagram, and I'm a grammar Nazi, so I just be trolling people over bad grammar, and they hate me.
My favorite thing to do is when I read somebody's comment and they mean to say like YOU apostrophe RE, but they put YOUR, and then I'm the next comment and it's like YOU apostrophe RE with the asterisk. Yeah,
that is me. That's me. That is me. That's all I say to fuck you, man. You know what I meant. Well,
no, I didn't.
Be better.
Yeah, we were raised such a different way than everybody else.
Yeah.
It's starting to show. I feel like there's enough time for our generation to do something significant.
We're also like the last pure generation of like children of like, I don't know if this is like a different like specific thing, like if there's a real definition for it, but I feel like we're the last like generation of the sun. Like we went out and we were like out there in the world. We
experienced.
We learned from the world as children. You know what I mean? What we could do, what we couldn't, what hurt us, what's not going to hurt us, what was safe.
Like last week we talked about this. I learned not to go out in the desert and hit stuff with the golf club because it's going to come back and hit me in the nuts real hard, and I'm going to be in pain.
There we go.
Exactly. Like you learn from trial
and
error. Kids
nowadays probably don't know that.
You learn from the real world, real life experience through that. And now we kind of just live it in a cyber aspect, even like relationship wise. We've got people that sit on the internet and live in a text relationship. Like they won't even talk to each other over like a phone or like look at each other. And it's crazy what the world has come to, you know. Like you used to have to go out there, get lucky to find somebody that meshed well with what you were looking for in a relationship. And now you kind of just post your interests and a computer matches you up, and hopefully you guys live happily ever after.
I remember when I was younger, I was trying to find a friend's phone number from school. So I busted out the phone book, and I was going through it.
And do they still drop off like new editions of the phone book?
Oh, yeah.
Like people still have house phones?
I do.
You have a house phone?
Yeah.
Fuck.
But
I got one, but I never answer them. Nobody ever answers
because
them.
It's always some motherfucker at dinner time.
It's like
time
a telemarketer.
Why do you even have a house phone?
But,
I understand I didn't pay my last electric bill when I lived at that other house, and you know, you sent me to collections, but you don't got to call me about it every day.
We know.
If you haven't got your money in 2 years, like, you're not getting it.
But yeah, when I went through the phone book, I was trying to find my friend, and like, there were probably 10, 15 people with that last name. And I went through and just started calling them.
Calling every one of them? You probably didn't know his like parents' name. Huh?
No.
Did you eventually find it though?
Yeah.
How many did you have to call before you found it?
Probably, I mean, this was years ago, maybe like 4 or 5, and just...
That's fortunate. It could have been a lot worse. Was it like a pretty common last name? Oh, man.
That's funny.
That's funny.
Well, you know, coming back to what we were talking about as far as...
The ginger.
No, the kid. The ginger playing kid. Basketball. What are you looking at?
The little fucker.
I feel like it's really our responsibility, though, to teach these kids better. And I could have spazzed the fuck out on that kid. But, you know, I understand that every time I step outside of my house, I'm taking that risk that day.
Yeah.
To deal with whatever comes across me. And that I have the power to make any decision the way that I want to make it. You know?
And that's the thing, you know, why blow up and create this crazy big, you know, just...
Well, I mean, at this point in life, you happen to be an adult. What if you were... How old would you say the kid was, like...
Shit. Maybe, like, 9.
What if you were 9? What if you were 9 and you just were not into taking that kid's shit that day?
Or what if I was some stranger like high on PCB or something coming by with a knife in my
that is true, but that's a whole nother extent. I'm just trying to break it down.
Life is so different for so many people. Just these kids need to realize that.
Like it's
these
crazy
kids need to realize that in particular. Life is different shit for different people, and it's okay. You don't need to go out of your way though to be a dickhead to somebody. You really, truly don't need to do that.
But the way kids...
I mean, unless you're trolling online, because it's fucking funny as shit.
It is funny. It's terrible, but it's funny. And I mean, I'm a hypocrite for saying this. Little fucking kids shouldn't be doing that. Like, they definitely should have a better sense of discipline and respect. But if I'm bored on Instagram as a fucking... 26-year-old man, and I want to go on there on like the 49ers Instagram and go through and tell everybody that I can go through. I'm a diehard 49er fan, have been for years. I mean, I know my team in and out, so you're not gonna hit me with any shit that's gonna, you know. I basically Eminem them, you know what I mean? Yeah. Like on 8 Mile, like I'm gonna tell you fucking anything and everything, and you're not gonna have anything to use against me because I'm gonna shit on you. Like I go there and troll them on some bullshit, like. And then, like, people get so fucking mad at me, and then I make them look silly at the end of the day. But it's, I don't know, I just get bored and I do that. I'm a dick.
I always like doing the grammar shit.
The grammar ones are the best because they'll continue to do it. You figure like it'll teach them a lesson. You're kind of just being a dick, but you'll still see a couple days later, you're my Valentine with a fucking YRUR or something. Wrong. It's like you are with an apostrophe an idiot.
you have to throw the little asterisk in there too.
Yeah, because you have to know, let them know they're wrong. That's how you let them know they're wrong.
That's hilarious.
Oh man. Well, I mean, other than some little fucker, Steven, do you have any crazy stuff? Crazy, funny, like wacky, kind of off the wall stuff that's happened to you recently?
Off the wall stuff.
Or just any story that you could really think of.
You know, even past or present.
Yeah. Life has been interesting as of late because I've had to deal with loss, which is something that I haven't had to deal with too much outside of my grandfather's and, you know, a bunch of family dogs, you know. But it's something that you know, it's a part of life. You know, grief is a part of, you know, losing somebody, and it's something that we all go through at least at some point in our lives.
Yeah.
You know,
especially when it's a very like a immediate family member, even like some sort of loss like that, even if it, whether it's death or even like a parting of a friendship or like a relationship, mm-hmm. Like man, when I abruptly lost my father, like I wasn't crazy close with my dad, but like it was my dad, you know what I mean? And as much as I might have resented some of the stuff he may have done in life, like that motherfucker raised me as great as he possibly could. Because now as a fully grown man, and I'm out here in the world, and I'm a father myself, and I take a lot of my father's teachings to an extent, not as rationally maybe as he would have taken it, but like man, like I couldn't have asked for a better upbringing from somebody that, like, when I was younger and I was a little fucker like that redhead, you know, like, I respect everything that guy did for me, yeah. Because if I didn't have that, absolutely. I have no clue where I would be right now, you know? Absolutely. And, like, when you lose somebody like that and it's, like, that person's gone forever, like, I didn't get to share graduating college with the guy. I didn't get to share my marriage with the guy. I didn't get to. He's never met my grandkids. They're never gonna meet their grandpa, you know. So like, I can totally understand. I got very reclusive when I lost my father, and like I didn't talk to anybody for like a year.
Absolutely.
I sat at Sueno Lane when I lived on Sueno Lane. I sat in like my apartment, did nothing but like just chill with my wife. And didn't really connect with anybody. Like, I was gone for a while.
Absolutely. And you learn to heal through all that, and you'll learn to become a better person. You know, we all go through what we go through in life to become better people.
It's been fun.
Absolutely.
Can't wait to see what the future has to hold for the Monkey House and Ziggy Braun and...
This has been fun, and it's a little different take of peer fuckery today, but I'd say I'm going to end peer fuckery on the note of alluding back to the intro, the story I have of how I was supposed to go to a big state college right out of high school and how that ended up not happening. All right, so what brought this up is we're talking about how St. Even... being the artist that he is, you know, draws pictures, paints, makes music, produces his own beats. I'm not sure. Do you play any instruments?
I play the trombone and the violin. Oh, he plays some of the keyboard too.
Keyboard.
All right. So, I mean, he's a full-blown artist, and he's an actor. So, in high school, I believe it, what was it, senior year? Seussical was senior year?
Seussical was senior
year. The Seussical was senior year. It was a musical. It was like a compilation of like Dr. Seuss stories, right?
Yeah, Dr. Seuss
stories. In a musical form.
I played Horton the Elephant.
Nice. That was the lead act, though, was it not? Or
I was the lead role, one of the lead roles.
All right, so he basically, one of the big stars up there.
That's fine.
I go to see this with a couple of my buddies. Gonna mention the infamous Yak again. He's been mentioned a couple times. We're gonna get the Yak on here. We've got Yak. We've got my boy Jordan Austin, who's up in San Francisco right now. I miss that guy. It was pretty much the crew I rolled with at that time. My boy Arneezy. And that was pretty much the crew. That was a little bit before Dylan Drugs, and you know, he'll have some peer fuckery stories of mine that I'll tell later down on the road. But at this time, this was our crew, and
This was
circa 2009. Circa 2009, and it was Hummus Crew, man. That was my crew. That was our skate crew. We were little skate rats. Went out there, fucked shit up. We were a bona fide crew, man. Like we rolled deep together, no matter where we went. Anyway, getting off topic, but we went to the Seussical because you know we got tickets. We went and saw some of our friends that were in the play, and I had SAT scheduled that Saturday morning. The next day that we went to the play on a Friday night, And I had SAT scheduled at 8 in the morning at Victor Valley High School. And so we go to this play. Play's over. We see a buddy that was there to see the play as well. And he's like, yeah, we're throwing a party. Throwing a party. Yeah, you guys come through. You know, we got a connect that can get us some liquor. So if you're down to pitch in, you know, we put a couple ends on it, get some liquor. Because, I mean, at that time, we're like 17, 18 years old. So, of course, we're not buying our own liquor. So we go to this party. Symphony Homes. Over there off Elevado. go party all night. Call my dad beforehand. Of course, I have to do that. Because at this point of the night, like, I'm so caught up in hanging out Friday night with all my friends that I completely fucking forget that I have an arrangement in the morning. And my dad doesn't even know about it. So, or, like, know enough about it to, like, sit there and remember. Because, I mean, he's it's his Friday. The guy worked long hours. He worked his ass off. So, last thing on his mind is giving a fuck about my SATs. You know, whether I really informed him well about it or not. So I hit him up. I was like, hey, I'm going to stay at Yak's house tonight. Is that cool? Yeah, fuck it. Whatever, man. Just get a ride over here in the morning. I don't want to come fucking pick you up. No problem. Yeah, I'll be there. I'll be there before 12. All right, whatever. Get off the phone. Go party all night as like a, you know, young 17, 18. Well, I was 17. Most of my friends were 18 by the time, but I graduated at 17, so I was still 17 at the time. Drinking alcohol, which wasn't supposed to do. So getting real fucked up, partying, mingling with the ladies, because that's what it was about at that time. You know, party until probably we drank till probably like 4 or 5 in the morning. Crashed out at this dude's house. In some extra room on like the bottom bunk of a bunk bed of whoever's room I was in, but that's all I know about that. I wake up in the morning, passing out at like 4 in the morning. Wake up at like 11:30, 12 in the afternoon. Thank God that the Symphony Homes were not too far away from where I lived. I lived right off Mojave. So just busted a little mission, and this is in reference to Victorville, California. So if you don't know where
Victorville
repping. So I bust a mission home, and by bust a mission, I mean I woke my ass up, realized that I was almost not home before 12 when I told my dad was, and I fucking sprinted home. I took Elevado to Mojave. And you guys know where I lived, right? Yeah, off Mojave, right? So
over by Hook, right?
Yeah, over by Hook Park. Sprinted down there. It's pretty tough run.
Yeah. Oh yeah.
I get there and my dad's like, where the fuck you been? I told you I'd be here before 12. Yeah, well, why weren't you at your SATs today? Oh. Fuck. Like he was like, I got a phone call from the school saying that I missed the SATs, and I had just prior to that, probably a month before, taken a trip down to San Diego State University. Yeah, because I submitted an application there. Pretty much they ran my stuff. They said, you know, your qualifications are all good. You just haven't taken the SATs yet, which is one thing we need you to do. And pretty much as long as you ride like about a little average to a little above average line, you're good to go. I even put preparation into this, studying, doing like the practice tests, and I go and blow it for one night of fucking getting drunk at some random fucker's house in the Symphony Homes. I end up going to junior college for like 20 years. 20 years, and then finally graduating from an art institute with a degree, an associate's degree in audio engineering. So, I mean,
hey, there we go.
My life could have been way different.
You did something, though. That's all.
But now I'm just recording podcasts in my garage.
I could throw down a pure fuckery if you don't want to introduce yet.
Oh, no. Just
down, throw one down.
Go for it.
So, as us here know, you know, Jimmy's house was an avid kind of party spot.
don't
growing up.
Don't even bring up this house because now I'm gonna have to tell stories and I've got a lot of them.
So, it was the house right off. I think it was Concord over there by the liquor store at the corner, like Mojave and Condor. Condor. There we go. And so we were over at that house, not the cul-de-sac house, but the two garage door house.
Yeah, the original one.
Yeah. With the pool. Jimmy, yeah, exactly. And you know, it was like a Friday night, and we're just, you know, taking it's culture. Bitch.
Oh, I'm sorry. I just remembered the story I'm gonna tell after this.
So we're taking the Jaeger bombs and, you know, shots of tequila and beers and just all sorts of stupid shit, and my parents owned this rental house over off Village, which was pretty close by. And I get this call at, you know, probably around like midnight or something, and they're like, "Hey, the pipes burst in the front yard at the rental. Could you go and check it out?" And at this point of the night, it's kind of inebriated, you know. I'm like, all right, I'll go take care of it. But I found somebody to give me a ride because I didn't want to drive, of course. So I get a ride over there, and I walk over there and assess the situation. I'm kind of waddling over there, and there's these real amazing, nice Christian ladies that come out, and I'm just slurring my words and stumbling over there. And I noticed that there's just water just shooting out everywhere. I'm like, can you guys go get me a wrench? So they go inside and find me a wrench. I'm like, oh, I'm just going to go turn the water off. And handled it super well. Took care of the situation pristinely. I went over, turned the water main off, and went back over to where the pipe was burst. And I was like ankle deep in the mud. I was like, yeah, we're going to have to come back for this. And, probably fix it tomorrow, because there was no way to fix it that night. Like, I would have had to, you know,
just buried in water. Yeah.
Anyways, I get a ride back over to Jimmy's house, and I walk into their front door. So I'm like treading mud everywhere, and Mamacita comes by, and she's like, "What are you doing?" And like, I'm, you know, like ankle deep in mud, but you know, I took care of the situation somehow. I don't know how, but yeah, it was just it was an interesting event.
Pure fuckery.
Oh man.
Oh man, this week has been fun.
It's been cool.
We have a lot of content.
Got a lot of empty beers.
Let's get into the closing part of this show today, and
this journey we're taking together,
and let's start it off with reviewing our 2 6-packs of the week. We told ourselves we were only gonna do one, but we kind of had a mission to go in and do week 3 and 4 today, which we might have got out of it because of how much we recorded,
how much content we got.
Yeah, but you know, we drank 2 12-packs today of
the Deschutes. I can't even say it. The Deschutes Brewery Fresh Squeezed IPA.
Just wait till
IPA.
We start plugging, man.
Yeah, just wait till the plug. Yeah, we got the Deschutes Brewery Fresh Squeezed IPA and the Kona Brewing Longboard Island Lager. I'd have to say 2 of my most drank 6-packs that I could find at liquor stores. I actually got the chance to go to the Deschutes Brewery up in Portland, Oregon. And when we got up there, we were trying to figure out places to go to and drink, and we were talking to the some dude at the hotel, and he gave us a few options. You know, there was a bar where you could basically find every single beer from Portland, because Portland's become like one of the kind of like most notorious spots for beer in America at this point. And he said there's one bar you can go to, I think it was like across a river or something, or there's a spot called the Brewer's Block where you can go there, and there's literally all these breweries in one general area. So, you know, I wanted to get the full effect, the full experience. So I wanted to go to Brewer's Block and check out all the breweries. So we started with Deschutes Brewery, and it's more like a restaurant type place, a little more like mainstream, you'd probably call it. But yeah, the fresh squeezed IPA is a delicious IPA. Not too potent compared to some of the other ones, but it's a good one. And then you know, Kona Longboard, you just can't go wrong with anything from Kona, ever. I was debating between a few six packs for this week, but I ended up going with Kona because that was the first. I ended up going with the Longboard because that was the first beer that sort of introduced me to Kona, and it's just it's a phenomenal beer. Their Hanalei IPA is amazing. They incorporate all these tropical flutes. They incorporate all these tropical fruits. They have the Castaway IPA that has, it's like a passion fruit IPA. They have the Pipeline Porter, which actually takes Kona coffee beans and incorporates that into the beer. They have the Cocoa Brown.
Oh, man.
Which is it's a coconut brown ale.
That sounds great.
Yeah, they just anything from Kona, you'll get that. It's cool too because a lot of the IPAs that they have, they're not like the 8%ers that are just going to fuck you up and kind of leave you out of commission, you know, a few hours into the night. They're all, you know, pretty mellow, good beers, and they all just leave you with that tropical Hawaiian kind of aftertaste. Good stuff. Good stuff.
Right on, right on.
Hawaiian punch, but a beer form.
I enjoyed both. I'm not the beer man. Ziggy's our beer man. He's our connoisseur.
Yeah, I'm not much of a beer man myself.
I drink it. I'm definitely a beer drinking man, but I'm not the beer man that sits here and drops the knowledge on the beer like this man. Like this guy, he's a great spokesperson that he could be for both of these breweries. But I'm just gonna say, I guzzled them, I liked them, and I'm feeling good now.
I'm really enjoying the Deschutes.
Del Scorcho.
The Deschutes is really good. I like the citrus and grapefruit notes of this beer. It's really refreshing. I like that the hops are getting squeezed on the box, that there's a light blue color on the bottle, and a nice scarlet red.
It does have a real cool color scheme. I gotta say too, I think we've talked
Longboard
about this before.
Looks great too, though. Yeah, I say that.
And we've talked about this before. You know, I think it was during week one. Never, you know, there's that saying, "Never judge a book by its cover." But I'm gonna be honest. I've looked at a lot of beers and said I'm getting that based off of the label.
Like, and oh, that's gotta be a good microbrew.
And it ends up being pretty good. And it's like, you know, the color schemes and the artwork. That's one thing I love about the micro brews and some of the smaller brewing companies is just the artwork that they incorporate on everything. Like anything from Kona, they always have some crazy beach, ocean artwork on it. Waterfalls, surfing, paddleboarding, whatever it is. It's just cool.
I'm going to go ahead and say that I think that's really pretentious of them. I'm just joking. I'm just fucking with you. I know. If you know St. Even, you know I'm always off the wall saying some crazy shit. Hello, world.
Hello. His name is Saint.
Dot Eve.
Happy to be here with you guys.
Eve.
So you guys need to check out both of these breweries. First one we talked about, Deschutes Brewery, Deschutes,
not Dwight
Brewery. That was the fresh squeezed IPA. Again, I feel like I mention this every week. I probably say it every week, but you could probably, maybe, I guess, find them on like Facebook or Twitter or Instagram, whatever it is. I know for a fact. Actually, no. Yeah, I've seen Deschutes Brewery on Instagram, I think.
On the gram?
This is the best plug, right?
They definitely have a hashtag because I've already posted one.
Okay, cool. And then Kona Brewing Company definitely has an Instagram for sure. That was when I was on Instagram, that was definitely one of the pages I followed. Kona, K-O-N-A Brewing Company. You guys should know how to spell brewing company. That's cool. I'm not going to spell that out. This one we're drinking, Longboard. That's one of their originals, I imagine. Check it out. They got some cool shit. Oh, they got their website down here, www.konabrewing.com. Let's see if there's anything else on the bottom. Nah, check out their Instagram and everything. They're good. It's good people.
You guys can't see that, but this motherfucker is like trying to hold his face to the mic so that he can get this stuff recorded. He's, while holding a six pack over his head out of the peripherals, like trying
studying the shit out of it.
Man, he's making sure that you get he gets these plugged. Well, that's our beer review. Other than that, this has been a great episode of Beers in the Air with our interviewee, Saint Even from the Monkey House.
From the Monkey House. The Monkey House is forever. The Monkey House isn't going anywhere.
Saint Even.
The Monkey House is all up in your ears right now.
Big shouts to Kurt Vonnegut, too. That's where we got the name.
Shouts to Vonnegut.
If these people were to look you up somewhere, where would you like them to find you?
I would send them, I would refer them to my personal Instagram, at Steven Anaya. I feel like before... Surely anything, I'm Steven Anaya, and I can't escape that.
Steven with a V.
S-T-E-V-E-N. A-N-A-Y-A. Plug in that myself.
With the ad at the beginning. But,
just know that I don't do really any of this for money. I do this to connect with people and for the feeling that it brings. It's a beautiful thing.
It is.
That's awesome, and that's kind of the vibe we've gotten from you. Is like you're here... for the grassroots of it, and
for
not
the culture, baby.
Yeah,
and I feel
the
like
culture, since, babe.
I feel like since you know we've all kind of started doing music, my personal favorite thing that you just mentioned is just being able to connect with people. Like it's cool being able to share stories with people, being able to share.
That's
music
why I
people,
fuck with Mr. Ziggy Brown.
Share ideas with people.
He's always been really involved with other people. Not really shying away from touching the lives of other people, really connecting with people, entertaining them. So much fun. Well, I've had a lot of fun, and there's still a lot more fun to be had.
Just
whole
the,
hell of a lot more.
Just the sheer like different avenues that it can take you down, and like the different places it may take you, and the different people you meet that all share the same. Same interests as you, like the same, like simple goal of like you want to make some music that not only you want to hear, but like other people want to hear as well. Like even like it's crazy because you could sit here and you can listen to us and you could tell we're very musically inclined, but when you see us in a room together, it's like what those three guys, like those three, like
those three guys are the people that are talking right now.
Yeah, like those are the guys that, you know, like you never know what it's gonna bring you.
I think that's a really beautiful thing about our generation is we've all kind of grown up in the same way, really appreciating each other's presence and where we all come from. We've been able to give each other a chance. Hopefully we can pass it on to other generations to be tolerant enough to, you know, see what your fellow man is up to, regardless of how much differently he is than you are.
100%. I 100% agree. Well, thank you for being on episode 3 this week of
thank
Beers
you.
In the Air, Mr.
Beers
Saint Even.
Air.
All right, guys. You can find me on Instagram at GIBZAUDIO, Gibbs Audio. If you want to hit me up personally, talk anything, whether it's music, the podcast, getting yourself on here, finding out if we can help promote you and your independent ventures. In any way, because we're all about doing it ourselves, and we all know, you know, a little bit of help here and there can go a long way. You can also hit us up at ass.
You can hit us up ass.
You can hit our ass up
at ass
on Instagram aesthetic. As well at Aesthetic Intellect Records.
You can hit our ass.
And during the credits, we'll have everybody's plugs, and you'll be able to find us there. You know, thank you all for joining us. Thank
and,
you.
Real quick,
as well.
Too. I'm one day soon, maybe. I've been considering it. I'm thinking about making a Ziggy Brown page. So just keep an eye out. It's probably, you know, I'm planning it out. This is in the planning stages of the social media.
There's definitely a Yay Old Gents one coming pretty soon.
There's
so maybe
Yay
even
Gents.
Hit him on that one.
But, you know, maybe there's going to be a Ziggy Brown one, so just keep an eye out for it. I like keeping everybody surprised.
Never know. He's a man of mystery.
A man of mystery. Yeah. I'm the man.
This has been episode 3 of Beers in the Air. We'll see you all next week.
Bitch!
Thank you for tuning in to episode 3 of Beers in the Air, brought to you by Aesthetic Intellect Records. I'm your host, Gibbs, and with my co-host, Ziggy Braun, we bring you a brand new episode of this podcast every single Monday. Be sure to follow us and keep up to date with everything that's going on with the podcast and Aesthetic Intellect Records at Aesthetic Intellect Records on Instagram and YouTube.
I've been lied to, bust out, passed over and cussed out. Now I'm up nights, struggling to keep it in the uprights. No touchdown, I've been high but I cut down. Had to calm down, trying to stay sane. Got up in the game, it affected my brain. Now I feel like I've gone half nuts now. I came up in a rough town, town made me into town tough. KC Mo, where the crew is assessing, we built this thing from the ground up. I fall down but I bounced up, so grateful the tech found us. If he never would've done that, man, I'm wondering where in the hell I would've wound up. I'm a pound pup, but don't push this. You make a bad dog out of good pit. We could be BFs like Goodrich, long as I'm a little more than hood rich. My chakras are all lined up, energy flowing on the constant. When it bursts forth from my fingertips, it's a good night, no long kiss. Since 13, I've been clocked in. Since playground, I've been on point. Since capture enemy, I weighed in like an iron giant with a strong voice. Since matter no money, you could pay me 1979 when it made me. Now I change ways, trying to stay sane in these fast times and these strange days.
Here I go, fired up, glow same color as a fire truck. Last dragon on bam salt, up in the wag, I'm high as fuck. In the pocket, I'm popping off. Point, but not proper. Stealing energy from my enemies, taking in through my chakras. Steal verses, build curses. Every now and then I feel worthless. Walking around in the presence of greatness. Why would a nigga not feel nervous? Guess we gotta build purpose and rep the midi, it feels worth it. Came in the game with a ball and the chain and the damn thing changed. I'm still working, still lurking, still purping. Chonging out when I'm in the booth and my team is up to par. Y'all can hit the bar, I ain't lying to my shit's the proof. No capsize when I'm flowing. These waves don't play fair. I wade through my night dreams, backstroke through my daymare. They don't care, I don't either. Still rocking that white pleaser. Excess crew when we clicked up, so we roll with no leader. I'm in the mood to the repeater. I'm in a gunfight, packing the cleaver. And in the moment, my opponent better feel me like I was rapping the ether. The ether.
I ask for truth, you act aloof. I say some things to get back to you. Life's 10% what happens to you. Other 90%'s all attitude. I'm shatterproof, built strong enough to maintain my will. The will call you bluff. I'm doing this thing for all of us. If I lose my feet, I'm still falling up. I got a hand out, what's there for me? No ground to stand on, the air to breathe. You scared of me? I conquer my fear and receive power through clarity. Move carefully, we share a fate. You care for me, I care the same. Same story, they play poor me. Intimidation, interrogate. I serenade, they do the dance. Music I make, mood enhance. Move your hands, soothe your soul, make you go crazy, you lose control. What's beautiful, what's good to you, what's worth the process they put you through. Can't shake the pain on the day-to-day, it all fades away when I look at you. I push the truth, why live a lie, with a wound like this, I gotta survive. Got bills to pay, big fish to fry, excuse me while I kiss the sky. It's time, hands on the clock spun down, we're not gonna keep truth locked up. It's coming out, running out of options on the real, nobody gonna stop us.
Here we are, A-planin', maintaining, not man-tanning. Beating up the beat, heating up the street, Megatron in my hand cannon. I'm motoring, I'm in the mode again, energy over. Loading, I'm going in. Could it be we frozen? None colder than literally shogunning, honing my craft. They blinded by our shine. 81-6, it's our time. They don't know how the fuck we got here. Do the math on that. It was our grind. Y'all fading out like a star dying. Scared to fail, but don't start trying. This, I bet you better kick the deck and eat dirt with all of these darts flying. Our rhyming is hard timing. Staring up at our stars lining. Posted up in a gold mine, and my whole mind is on cloud nine. We don't need thumbs up, no cosign. These dumb fucks wanna blow lines. Long as it's on your dime, I don't give a shit. No, I don't mind. The snake in the back are back in the back of the building, stacking the mini, wrapping a circle around him, and everybody getting the squad is packing the mini. Back in a minute, y'all already know what time it is. See the rappers, the gimmick, say my mind's the only weapon I'ma get to use. I'm attacking them with it. Dig it, dig it, dig it.
Strange music.